everyone, it's Justin again. In this lesson, we're going to focus on reviewing the properties, theorems, and definitions you've learned so far in this course and applying them as justifications for statements. By the end of this lesson, you will be able to apply previously learned properties, definitions, and theorems to justify statements. First, you will complete the property review activity in the PDF. Next, we'll review the difference between equality and congruence. Finally, we'll complete 3 practice problems. In your notes template PDF for this lesson, you'll find an activity titled Property Review. You'll want to complete this activity before continuing on with this video. We're not going to be going over the answers together, so be sure to check in with an adult and check the answer key before resuming this video. Pause here to complete the property review activity. If you're back, you should have already completed the property review activity in your notes and have checked your answers. Let's move on to the next item on our agenda. Congruent and equals are both used to show that two things are identical, so it can be tricky to remember when to use an equal sign and when to use a congruence sign. The easiest way to remember the difference is that an equal sign, or equality, only applies to numbers, while congruence applies to lines, angles, and figures. Let's practice a little sorting. Here are 6 statements. Look them over and decide whether the blank should be filled with an equal sign or a congruence sign. I'll give you a hint and tell you that there are going to be 3 of each in the end. Pause the video here to sort them yourself. Let's start with angle DOG and angle CAT. These are referring to the angles, so that means I need congruence. Now if we look at the measure of angle DOG and the measure of angle CAT, this is referring to how big the angles are in degrees, which is a number. So this one is equality. Take a look at these two together next, since there's only a very small difference between them. The one on the right has the segment notation above LA and MP, while the one on the left does not. If you think way back to Unit 1, can you remember what the difference is between these? When we use the segment notation, we are referring to the segments themselves. When there's no segment notation, we're referring to the length of the segment. Knowing that, how would you categorize each of these? When we have segment notation, we need congruence. When there's no segment notation, we would use equality since we are talking about length, which would be a number. 2 more to go. How about triangle GLD and triangle FSH? This is talking about the whole triangle, so this is congruence. And lastly, we have 5 plus 8 and 13. Those are all numbers, so we are talking about equality. Here's our first example. There are 2 questions that we have here about the quadrilateral on the left. The first asks which 2 angles are alternate interior angles formed by PA and RT. This diagram looks a little different than back when we learned about transversals in Unit 3, but we can visualize it in a way that's more familiar. Maybe something like this. All I've done here is extend PA, RT, and RP, and I've temporarily made PT and RA a little less visible so that they don't distract us. I have not actually changed the diagram at all. This is a great example of how you can expand on the diagram on your paper and help yourself visualize things in an easier way. If you couldn't tell before, go ahead and identify which 2 alternate interior angles are formed by PA and RT. Did you identify angle 2 and angle 3 since they are on the opposite sides of the transversal that crosses PA and RT? Nice job. Can you see how angles 1 and 4 aren't actually formed by PA and RT? The other interior angles formed by PA and RT would be these 2 much larger angles that were not a part of our original diagram. Now let's look at our other segments. Which 2 angles are the alternate interior angles formed by RA and PT? take a look at this adjusted diagram to help give you a better picture. Angles 1 and 4 are alternate interior angles formed by RA and PT. If you ever find yourself using a diagram like this, you can always sketch on it like I've done here to help make it easier for you to interpret. Just make sure that you don't add in any new information. Next up is example 2. We have a new diagram with 4 new angles. Let's work our way down the list of statements and questions on the right, starting from the top. Given the diagram to the left, angle 1 and angle 3 are blank. This is a great preview of the process of writing out proofs. You always want to start as simple as possible, so don't worry about the relationship between their measures yet. What type of angles are 1 and 3 together? They're vertical angles. How do you know they're vertical angles? Your answer for this one should be one of the properties from the property review. Since we're dealing with lines and angles here, I'll give you a hint that you'll find it in section 3. What property could we use to show how we know angles 1 and 3 are vertical angles? We can use the vertical angles definition because this helps us identify vertical angles from a picture. Now that we know that angles 1 and 3 are vertical angles, what else do we know about them? Vertical angles are always congruent. Which one of those properties from the review activity tells me that? The vertical angles theorem. You'll find that this is a very consistent pattern throughout this unit. Whenever you want to make a statement about the relationship between two angles or segments, you'll first need to state a definition that lets you label them. And then you can use a theorem or postulate that allows you to state their relationship. Let's do this last one together. Now that we know that angles 1 and 3 are congruent, I also know that their measures are equal. Remember, since the measure of an angle is a number of degrees, we use an equal sign for it. We know this because of the congruence definition for angles. You'll find yourself using the definition of congruence a lot throughout this unit to move between a congruent statement and an equation. It's one of the most important properties because by allowing us to write an equation, we can also do things like solve, substitute, or manipulate. For our last example, we're going to continue using the same diagram, but now instead of working with angles 1 and 3, we're working with angles 1 and 4. Using example 2 as a guide, go ahead and see how far you can get on your own in example 3. Were you able to identify that angles 1 and 4 are a linear pair? We know this because of the linear pair definition, which helps us identify them from the diagram. Once we know that angles 1 and 4 are a linear pair, we can also conclude that angles 1 and 4 must be supplementary. Which property lets us conclude this? The linear pair postulate. And then, the most tricky one is once we know that angles 1 and 4 are supplementary, then what else can we say about them? Well, what do we know about supplementary angles? The sum of their measures is 180 degrees. So we can say that the measure of angle 1 plus the measure of angle 4 will equal 180. Which property is it that tells us this? The supplementary definition. Now you can accurately use congruence and equality in the appropriate situations and apply the properties we've learned so far in this course to justify statements. See you next time. Hey!